Good morning, everybody. Welcome to Mass. I know there's people out there. Come on in. And grab a seat. We're going to sing together. to you. Your glory like a fire, awakening desire, will burn our hearts with truth. You're the reason we're here. You're the reason we're singing. Open up the heavens, we wanna see you. Open up the floodgates, a mighty river flowing from your heart and filling every part of our praise. Your presence, your glory on our face, we're looking to the sky. Descending like a cloud, you're standing with us now. Lord, unveil our eyes. You're the reason we're here. You're the reason we're singing. We wanna see you. Open up the floodgates, a mighty river flowing from your heart. It's filling every part of our praise. We sing, open up the heavens. We wanna see you. Open up the floodgates, a mighty river flowing from your heart. Show us your glory. Show us your power. Show us your glory, Lord. Show us your glory. Show us your power. Show us your glory, Lord.
Sing that again.
Oh, show us your glory. Show us your power. Show us your glory, Lord. Your heart, it's filling every part of our praise. We sing, open up the heavens. We wanna see you. Open up the floodgates. A mighty river flowing from your heart. It's filling every part of our praise. Show us your glory. Show us your power. Show us your glory, Lord. Show us your glory. Show us your power. Show us your glory,
creating one, God Almighty. Through your Holy Spirit, conceiving Christ the Son, Jesus our Savior. I believe in God our Father. I believe in Christ the Son. I believe in the Holy Spirit. Our God is three in one. I believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again. For I believe in the name of Jesus. Oh, I believe. Our judge and our defender suffered and crucified. Forgiveness is in you. Descended into darkness, you rose in glorious light. Forever seated high. Oh, I believe in God our Father. I believe in Christ the Son. I believe in the Holy Spirit. Our God is three in one. I believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again. For I believe in the name of Jesus. And I believe in you. Yes, I believe you rose again. Yes, I believe that Jesus Christ is Lord.
Let's sing that again together. I believe.
Oh, yes, I believe in you. Yes, I believe you rose again. Yes, I believe that Jesus Christ. Eternal, I believe in the virgin birth. I believe in the saints' communion and in your holy church. I believe in the resurrection when Jesus comes again. For I believe in the name of Jesus. I believe in God our Father. I believe in Christ the Son. I believe in the Holy Spirit. Our God is three in one. I believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again. For I believe in the name of Jesus. For I believe in the name of Jesus. Oh, I believe in the name of Jesus.
Sing one more time.
I believe in God our Father. I believe in Christ the Son. I believe in the Holy Spirit. Our God is three in one. I believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again. For I believe in the name of Jesus. Oh, I believe in the name of Jesus.
Thank you, Lord, that we can believe. Believe and belong and become, Lord, all that you've called us to be. We thank you for this day, Lord, that we can worship you, honor you, and give you a rightful place in all of our lives, in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, turn around and say hello this morning to somebody. I've got my helper here with me, helping me with the announcements this morning. So all of our online folks that are watching this, this is Gideon, this is my grandson. And he's going to be my big helper this morning. Get our announcements. Just a few announcements before we head into the rest of the service. Looking forward to this morning's message as always. And we've got lots of things coming up in December. We have at the end of this coming week, this coming Saturday, we have our men's conference that's coming up in Brantford for the morning. It goes from 8:30 in the morning until 3:00 in the afternoon. So we've got about nine or so guys, maybe nine and a half. I don't know, maybe you're the half guy that's still kind of has got your name on the sheet. If you haven't put your name on the sheet and you want to come, then it's out on the front desk. And we're going to work out the carpooling and things like that. So all those guys that have their name signed up there, I'll get in touch with you and let you know what the plan is for this coming Saturday. Then we have our What's Our Potential Sunday that we're looking forward to, just inviting all those that we haven't seen for a little while and those that are that come to mind. If we've got those that you want to invite, we want to see as many people in these in our chairs. I remember God said to me once, you know, you put the chairs out and I'll fill them. You know, so I can believe we can see as many friends and family that we can gather together for December the 4th for our What's Our Potential Sunday. After that, we've got our Christmas banquet that's coming up the following Sunday during our morning service, 11 o'clock, and we're going to have some postcards that are just in development right now, and so we'll get them to you, and you're going to be able to hand them to your friends and neighbors for a free complimentary Swiss Chalet chicken dinner. So we'll just be thinking about that, who you can invite to the Christmas banquet. There's going to be gifts for all the kids, and there's going to be door prizes and all that stuff, and singing Christmas carols, etc. So it's going to be a great time of family together. And I think that's all the announcements that I have. I'm going to release the children to children. No junior youth this morning. All right, that's right. You keep the Harms family in prayer. They're kind of battling something, some sickness at home. So, all right, so we'll release the children to children's ministry, and I'm going to invite Jim to come up and share the word.
Thank you, Dave. Good morning. So, a while back, the Alaska Department of Fish and Game put out an advisory to hikers, hunters, and campers to get on the alert for bears. Foremost, they said, be careful not to get too close to them. Okay, that's easy, got it. It said, we advise that hikers wear noisy little bells on their clothing so as not to stumble on a bear and startle him. They also said to carry a bottle of pepper spray in case of an encounter with a bear. And it went on to say that it is also a good idea to watch for fresh signs of bear activity. Outdoorsmen should recognize the difference between black bear droppings and grizzly bear droppings. It said black bear droppings are small and contain lots of berries and squirrel fur. Grizzly bear droppings have little bells in them and smell like pepper. That's encouraging, but I'm going to need a little more help than that. You know, and I guess as I get older, it's becoming more and more my response to trite answers about the challenges of life, books that promise five easy ways, or sermons even, five simple ways to this, check your boxes. Things aren't always that easy, and sometimes I need a little more help than that. And so that's why my message today is why I need the Bible. I guess I could have said why you need the Bible, but in a sense, there's a personal connection here in thinking through why this fellow, Jim Toon, needs the Bible. And we're going to look at Scripture together, and I'd like us to start with 2 Timothy 3, 14 to 17. Now, we'll throw it up on the screen there. If you have a physical Bible, you can also use that. But I'd like to invite you to stand with me as we read our scripture today. 2 Timothy chapter 3, verses 14 through 17. But as for you, continue in what you have learned and have become convinced of, because you know those from whom you learned it, and how from infancy you have known the Holy Scriptures, which are able to make you wise for salvation through faith in Christ Jesus. All Scripture is God-breathed and is useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness, so that the servant of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. Okay, go ahead and have a seat. I want to make a few observations very quickly from our text. You'll see that there are 5 points this morning. I'm going to run very quickly through probably the first three of them anyway, because there's one in particular that I want to dwell on for a little while with you this morning that I think might be particularly helpful and needful. So first of all, in your notes is this: I need the Bible, number one, because it's a message from God to us. It's a message from God to us. The NIV translates it quite well here. It says that all Scripture is God-breathed. All Scripture is God-breathed. Well, then you might ask the question, who wrote the Bible? And the answer to that is that Scripture has a dual authorship. On the one hand, God wrote it. On the other hand, men wrote it. Or in other words, God spoke and people spoke. And here's what's being conveyed by Paul to Timothy. Paul is saying that God breathed out the Scriptures with its reliability and with its authority, that God has spoken in such a way as to reveal truth and at the same time preserving the human authors from error, and doing so in such a way that would not violate those authors' personalities. So it's accurate then to say that God spoke, but also men spoke using their faculties freely, and their own personalities shone through in their writing style. Yet they were able to do this without distorting the message that God wished to convey. Did you get those 2 points? God uses human personality without violating it and keeping men from error, and then men, using their own human faculties, wrote things down without distorting the message. Now, there's one classic reference to this I like. It's in 2 Peter 1, and there Peter, speaking of the work of God through the Scripture, says in verse 21, "For prophecy never had its origin in the will of man, but men spoke from God as they were carried along by the Holy Spirit." Carried along by the Holy Spirit. Now, this Greek word for carried along, furamenoin, is a very interesting word. We see it again in Scripture in Acts 27. If you're familiar with that chapter at all, it's the story of the shipwreck involving Paul and others. And you will discover that this same verb is used to describe what was happening to their vessel in the midst of that storm. And you see it twice in verse 15 and once again in verse 17 of Acts 27. Luke records that as a result of the power of the storm, their vessel was simply driven along. It was driven along as a result of the influence of the power of the wind. This is exactly the picture, the metaphor that's used here by Peter. He says that men were driven along as they raised the sails. The Holy Spirit filled the sails. And the Scripture did not originate in their will. It wasn't like one of them came down for breakfast one day and said, well, you know, I think I'll write the Bible today. They wrote to their issues. They wrote to their time. They wrote to their culture. And they were driven along, carried, moved by the Spirit of God. The process wasn't mechanical. It's not like they were just like robots sitting at a word processor, like inanimate objects, then all of a sudden, you know, something happens to them, zapping them, and they're like, click, 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 click. Okay, there's Isaiah chapter 1. And then, you know, a few minutes later, click, 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 there's Isaiah chapter 2. There's no sense in which this was a mechanical process. And if you've read your Bible, you know it doesn't read as such. The individuals wrote according to their own personalities, according to their own styles, according to their own degree of literacy. Sometimes that's very obvious, and according to their own circumstances. And you read the Bible and you see it clearly. You take Amos. You read Amos and it's got a real bite. You know, it's got a real edge to it. You bald-headed rascals. Dark days and shaved heads and I'm coming to get you. I'm coming after you. He must have been an interesting character, Amos. And so Amos is known as a prophet of God's justice. But then you read Hosea, and it's got a very different feel. It's warmer. It's more tender. So no wonder when you read the book of Hosea, you would see that he would be a prophet of God's love. When you look at the New Testament, again, you see the different personalities and circumstances shining through. Paul is the apostle of grace and faith. James is the apostle who addresses the subject of works. John, the apostle of love. And Peter, not surprisingly, the one who concentrates so much on hope. So who wrote the Bible? Well, ultimately, God wrote the Bible, but he used men. And I need the Bible because it's the only book I know that contains the inspired words of God. The Bible is God's message to us. Secondly, I need the Bible because it's a book about Jesus. It's a book about Jesus. And the more you read it, the more you see Jesus showing up in every book of the Bible in some way. It teaches us about the life of Christ. And so the Bible is, in fact, in an overarching way, a book about Jesus. The Bible cannot be understood absent of what it says about the mission, work, content, and life of Jesus Christ. At one of our training center courses, where Impact is hoping to bring these back at some point and even offer them to folks at Emmaus. I know Karen here was a part of a number of our classes. I'm not going to ask you. Okay. See, she's always complaining. She's all, encourage one another, sister. No, you're right about that. I'll ask you this, because you should be able to just fill in these blanks without any help from me, but I won't put you on the spot. This was a mantra. We used to teach it again and again when we did our course on the Bible. In the Old Testament, Jesus is predicted. In the Gospels, Jesus is revealed. In the Acts of the Apostles, Jesus is preached. In the epistles, he is explained. And in Revelation, he is expected. Okay? He's predicted, he's revealed, he's preached, explained, and expected. Thirdly, I need the Bible because it makes me wise to salvation. And that's connected directly to a hinge that hinges onto our next point, number four. I need the Bible because it equips me to live out my salvation. So let's look at the two of those together. I need it because it makes me wise to salvation, but I also need it because it helps me to live out my salvation. In other words, it shows us how to be saved, and it shows us how to live when we have been saved. You could put it this way. It teaches us what to believe, and it teaches us how to behave once we believe. It gives us our creed, but it also assigns us our deeds. You see, I need this book because, as Paul says to Timothy, the Holy Scriptures are able to make you wise for salvation through faith in Christ Jesus. Wise to salvation. But here's the equipping part. Here's the deeds. And the Holy Scriptures are useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness so that the man or the woman who belongs to God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. Friends, I need the Bible because no other book will do that for me. None. I mean, sure, there are helpful books out there, and I want to tell you, I can almost assuredly tell you that I am probably the most devoted student, or was, to the idea of positive thinking, self-help, whatever the mind can conceive and believe it can achieve, that kind of success literature, seminars, events, conferences, all of that genre, no bigger student on the subject of success and personal growth, and went through in the late 80s and early 90s when I was a self-employed financial advisor in my peak earning years. I saturated myself in Dale Carnegie and Anthony Robbins courses and Seven Habits books and Bob Proctor seminars, all of my sales associates and staff. I registered them in this stuff too. And it did motivate and it did shock my commissions and theirs to higher levels. But fundamentally, it lacked the power to change a human heart. So my production charts were moving up and to the right. But in so many other ways, my personal life in so many levels was going straight to hell. And God had no place. I was the master of my fate. I was the captain of my soul. And I just want to tell you, that's a very, very dangerous place to be. I won't go into the myriad ways in which my personal life and relationships began to unravel in a downward spiral. But clearly, to turn myself around, I needed more than a few good books. I needed more than self-help, determination, a strong work ethic, and willpower. And near my lowest point, I picked up a book by Tony Robbins called Awaken the Giant Within. Perhaps some of you have actually read that book, and I've shared with you before. It occurred to me in a moment of truth that my giant was already wide awake. This man inside of me did not need any further stirring or awakening. In fact, he needed to be chopped down. I needed to kill the giant within. And all the books I was reading, seminars I was taking, I'm not saying they were bad things, but they couldn't really fix me. They couldn't. Ultimately, they couldn't change my heart. They couldn't accomplish something so radical as what the Bible describes as literally being reborn or born again, a transformation, a metamorphosis, and changing the course and trajectory of my life today and into eternity. And so for me, it began with the Bible. We weren't going to church. I wasn't going to church. I hadn't gone for some years at that point, but I picked up a Bible in my confusion and despair and opened to Matthew 5. And I read this. Now, when he saw the crowds, he went up on a mountainside and sat down. And his disciples came to him, and he began to teach them, saying, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven." In Luke, it just says, "Blessed are the poor." And as I ran through the Beatitudes, it was like Jesus took everything I was pursuing, everything I esteemed, and turned it upside down. You've got it wrong, Toon. You've got it upside down and backwards. And before I was even regularly going to church again, I memorized the entire Sermon on the Mount. And the words of Christ, recorded in the Word of God, made me wise for salvation through faith in Jesus Christ. And no other book will do that. You see, in the Bible, God was and is speaking to us. And I've just learned in my life, mostly the hard way, the ultimate answers to life's soulish questions aren't found within. Look within, people tell you. You do you, people tell you. Follow your heart is the mantra of our world today. But as I said before, I'm afraid I'm going to need a little more help than that. The ultimate answers to life's soulish questions are not to be found within. And if you saw my within, you wouldn't trust it either. And it's not found in self-help or psychology or philosophy. I've discovered and I've come to believe that in the Bible, God was and is speaking to us. And I believe the Bible claims as much. So I look not within, but down into the pages of this book. And as I look down into the pages of this book, I in fact look up. That's where truth comes from. That's where wisdom comes from. That's how I become wise unto salvation. But I need to tell you that somewhere along the line, may I say the church has fumbled the ball on this. We don't look up like we should. And it's the sorry condition of our entire society. And so I want to just give a little grossly abbreviated history lesson and see what you think. You see, from the first century, people in Western civilization spent very little time wondering where to look when it came to discussions about wisdom and values. They just looked up. They looked up to a god or to God. The overwhelming majority of the populace lived with the awareness of a code of transcendent values that was derived from Judaism or Christianity. The Bible was the centerpiece of the values for Christians, the Old and the New Testament, and the Old Testament for the Jews. Now, to be sure, in that time period, nobody ever lived up to these transcendent values perfectly. I'm not here giving a defense of Western civilization. That's not my point. This book has been misapplied, misunderstood, and used by people driving agendas for self-interest or unholy motives. So nobody really lived up to these transcendent values perfectly. Of course not. My point is they knew where the values came from. They knew where to look. They knew what the values were. They knew who wrote them. The values were accessible, understandable, and unmistakable. And people aspired to live up to these values, even if they didn't pull it off, right? Most people aspired to. Parents taught their kids to live up to these values. Punishment of one degree or another was meted out to people who disregarded these transcendent values, and awards and honors were conferred upon those who practiced them and lived them out authentically and heroically. So for hundreds of years, Christians and Jews told stories of the heroes of the Bible. David, who stood up to Goliath, the value of courage. Job, who endured suffering and never caved in. We see their perseverance. Esther, the heroism of this woman who risked her life to save her people. Later on, from the teachings of Jesus, parables were taught to children in each succeeding generation to uphold certain values, such as, well, the parable of the Good Samaritan. Parents would read that story, teach that story to their kids, and say, now, that's what you need to be. Do that. Be a good Samaritan. Holy days and sacraments tied people to the author of these transcendent values. And this scenario rolled on century after century without much change until about the 18th century. And this is known as the time of the Enlightenment. And during this 150-year span of time, three thinkers emerged that taught people, don't bother looking up anymore. There's no need to look up. Actually, there were more than three. I'm just focusing on three for our purposes this morning. These authors, these philosophers, argued forcefully that humans were deceiving themselves in all of this looking up process. These philosophers said, you know, you shouldn't look up for a transcendent code of values. You should look within yourself to derive your own code, your own sense of values. And let me say to you that the position of these philosophers has won the day. If you go to the library, buy a book, watch TV, listen to the philosophy and statements of internet influencers and those sort of things, you'll see this kind of thinking has become the default mode of our culture today. Just look within. You see, one philosopher said, what must be trusted is reason. Pure human reason, as though pure human reason exists. But this guy's name was Immanuel Kant. Brilliant guy. And the short story on him is he felt it was demeaning, even silly, for mankind to look up and learn what the transcendent code was and get on board with that. What a cop-out, he exclaimed. You're smarter than that. You can think and meditate and eventually figure out all by yourself what values and moral choices are right for you. And as each person in society does their part and looks within, and they does the work of personal, diligent, sound reasoning, it'll all come out in the wash and everyone will make right choices, and this became known as rationalism. Not looking up, but looking to the human mind to derive a conduct for a morality, for choice-making. And it had quite a following. The next enlightened thinker agreed with Kant that human beings don't need to look up for values assistance. He too said that all we need to do is to look within. But he said, instead of looking into your mind to reason through it, to figure out the nature of right and wrong, he said, no. Don't look to your mind. You know, the mind just is not capable of logic. Look to your heart. And he was a Swiss-born philosopher by the name of Jean Rousseau. And he argued that children are born with beautiful hearts. And if parents would only let that inborn beauty unfold without any pressure or coaxing with regard to religious values, the children would eventually blossom into roses and marigolds and sunflowers, not dandelions, poison ivy, or skunkweed. Now, some of you may be wondering, did this guy have kids? You know, actually, Rousseau had five of them, and he ended up putting all five of them in an orphanage. But to Rousseau, each person's heart, except for his own kids, apparently, was bursting with goodness. And as long as nobody messed with so-called higher laws, as long as nobody interjected repressive religion of any kind into the system, everyone's inner goodness would eventually flow out of them. People would get along wonderfully well, and our world would be a wonderful place, a utopia, a paradise for everybody to live. And some of you may believe that, but it's not what the Bible teaches. As far as the real truth about you and me, the Bible says something different. Rousseau basically said, don't look up, you fools. Look within yourselves. Follow your own heart. And I've seen a lot of people mess up their lives doing just that. I mean, really mess them up. The third thinker that made his contribution to the values discussion, and probably my favorite philosopher to read, actually, is Friedrich Nietzsche. And he said, don't waste your time looking up for anything, because there's nobody home up there. God is dead. He said, look within yourself. Don't look to your mind, though. That's rationalism. Don't look to your heart. That's romanticism. He said, look to your will. To your will. Power. The power of your will. Take charge of your life, Nietzsche challenged his followers. Make your own way in the world, and you write the rules that get you where you want to go. Nietzsche had no use whatsoever for any religious-based value systems that he believed weak people hung on to. The weak hung on to religious value systems because they needed it for solace and comfort, or as a crutch, as people like to say. He felt strong people should resist any and all attempts to impress transcendent values on anyone else. Power up and do what you need to do. Survival of the fittest. It's the will. The will. One of the greatest pieces of Nazi propaganda well before World War II was produced, I think maybe around 1935, and it was a movie called The Triumph of the Will. And it showed German military might, Nazi rallies, the triumph of the will. And Hitler was powerfully affected by Nietzsche, justified many of his horrendous actions by quoting his philosophies, namely that the strong have an inherent right to rule in whatever way they see fit. Children who were born in poor health needed to die, children and adults. Anything was right in the name of power. The strongest have the right to execute their will. And about 6 million Jews paid the price for Adolf Hitler's fascination with Nietzsche's philosophies. Now, I could list the names of other influential Enlightenment philosophers, but the point I want to make here is that from the time of the Enlightenment on, a slow but steady erosion occurred in Western civilization, a shift away from looking up, a shift away from buying into the values and wisdom of the Bible. It was a shift towards looking within ourselves, to our minds, our hearts, our wills, to define how we should live in this world, to figure out what's right and wrong, what's true and what's false. And so the question we need to ponder for a few moments today is this. Where has this brought us as a society? And if you want to think about it more broadly, if we stay on this path and continue to stay on this path, where will it take us? I think a compelling case can be built just by looking at newspapers and history books for the past 100 years, the 20th century. After 150 years of Enlightenment thinking, was the bloodiest century on record. We entered the new millennium with some degree of hope, and then on September 11th, 2001, airliners smashed into the Twin Towers and other destinations in the United States, and it shook the entire world, and we have been trembling ever since. The new millennium does not look poised to turn things around by following the same philosophy that got us where we are. You say, look within. The Bible says in Jeremiah 17:9, the heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. Who can know it? Colossians 2:8 says, see to it that no one takes you captive through hollow and deceptive philosophy, which depends on human tradition and the principles of this world, rather than on Christ. The Bible says, don't look at your heart and the hollow philosophies of men. Look up, look up. And I would suggest that if we continue to look in rather than up for some transcendent set of values and expect a utopian society to emerge magically, we are sadly deceived. And you ignore and disregard this book at society's risk, at your neighbor's risk, and at your own risk and mine. So with the time that remain in this service, I don't want to hypothesize anymore on where a valueless society may be headed. I want to tell you where my life is headed if I untether myself from the values of this book. You see, I need the Bible, number five, because it is a book that knows me. It is a book that knows me. Hebrews 4, 12 and 13 says, the word of God is living and active, sharper than any double-edged sword. It penetrates even to dividing soul and spirit, joints and marrow. It judges the thoughts and attitudes of the heart. Nothing in all creation is hidden from God's sight. Everything is uncovered and laid bare before the eyes to whom we must give account. The word of God is living and active. It reveals us. It looks at us. James says that when we look into the Word, it's like looking into a mirror. The Bible understands me. It sees me. It knows me. You see, here's the straight scoop on me. You unhitch me from the teachings of this book. You allow me to make up my own rules, just to look to my own mind, my heart, or my will to define what's right and what's wrong in this world, and I guarantee you, I will gravitate in the general direction of my darker instincts. And between now and my last day, I will shipwreck my life. If you or I buy the lie that looking into our own souls for direction is a far superior idea than looking up to God for his clearly revealed truth, it's only a matter of time before the wheels come spinning off of our lives. Here's the deal with me. I've been a dedicated Christ follower for years, and to this day, I stand in awe of the southbound gravitational pull within me called sin that makes me want to rationalize what's really right and really wrong. It makes me justify my behavior when I cross lines that I know I shouldn't cross. And I still hear that dark whisper that says the right and wrong stuff doesn't matter that much. Rationalize it. Get your own way. Seek your own pleasure. Grab your own power. There will be no consequences. God won't care. No one will care. And the biggest lie, no one will get hurt. I hear those whispers, and I buy the lie periodically, sometimes knowingly, with malice aforethought. I violate the clearly spelled out transcendent values of this book. But there's also the truth about me. When it happens, I know it. When it happens, I recognize it immediately. I just know it. And a wave of remorse sweeps over me. And I'm like, how can I be so foolish as to get sucked into such stupidity again? You know, just recently I had to make an apology to someone for saying unwise and unkind words to them. And I've been a Christ follower for years, so I lost the battle of controlling my mouth. How we do with that one, church? Not long ago, following a church service, a few years back, a woman asked me to pray for her because her husband just took off and left her. And I had a little discernment bell ringing, so I asked her some clarifying questions, and she reluctantly confessed that maybe this fellow at work, her sort of but not exactly new boyfriend, contributed to the strain on their marriage. And I thought, man, deception knows no bounds. I mean, how deceived can a person be? She slammed dunking her husband for walking out the door while justifying the fact that she has begun to cross the line at the office with another man. A while back, a well-known Christian leader in the church planting world told me that he had gotten sideways with another respected Christian leader. And so they're slinging email mud back and forth, and occasionally even on social media in cyberspace. And if this thing blows, you know, a lot of people are going to be damaged. The leader I spoke with knows what the right thing to do is. It's to follow the biblical conflict resolution pattern that's established in Matthew 18, where Jesus said, you go to somebody that you're at odds with, and you sit down with them humbly, with a humble spirit, and attempt to reconcile. But the guy said, you know what? He feels so hurt and so wronged, he might just keep chucking mud for a little while longer. And do you realize the battle we're in every day between what is good and what is evil, what is right and what is wrong? Do you realize how important it is for that to be distinct in our minds, for us to be informed by the Bible, for us to be clear about what's right and what's wrong? The daunting challenge we are facing in this new millennium is the real presence of this thing called evil in the world. The Bible says that the evil one is a restless, roaring lion looking for people to destroy. And he's the one at work trying to keep us looking down instead of up, and within instead of above. And I'm telling you, friends, I need this book. I need its relentless reminders of what is right and what is wrong. True confession. I need the Ten Commandments. I need to be told by God himself that I should honor my parents, because sometimes I can rationalize dishonoring them. I need to be told, don't steal, because sometimes I rationalize stealing someone's reputation, maybe, by a little bit of gossip, taking what isn't mine. Have you stolen anything recently? The Ten Commandments say, don't steal. I need the Ten Commandments. I need the one that says, don't lie. Not even a little bit. Don't exaggerate. I need the one that says, don't commit adultery. Don't rationalize lust. Don't rationalize movies that stimulate lust. Do not commit adultery. I need the commandment that says, do not covet other people's stuff. Because sometimes I look at how the other guy or gal is doing, and some kind of dark feeling begins to, some competitive feeling or feeling of envy, or, you know, I don't have enough, I should have what they have. Because if I start looking at other people's stuff, I'm likely to jack my whole life and break my budget, take God's tithe, and try to spend it on trying to get what other people have. Don't covet. It's wrong, God says. It's destructive. I need the Ten Commandments, or I'll muddy up the waters of my value pool to the extent I don't know what's right and wrong. I need the challenges of the Sermon on the Mount to be a peacemaker instead of a divider of men and women. I need to be salt and light in the world instead of a convenience-oriented, just passer-through bystander in this world. I need where Jesus said, stop judging other people. I need the teachings of Jesus where he says, forgive those who have wronged you. That's the standard right there. That's the bar, friends. That's the right thing to do, is forgive those who have wronged you. I need the words of Jesus where he says, love your enemies. Or when he says, never return evil for evil, but return evil with what? Good, with good. I need that. I need it right in my face on a regular basis. I need these kinds of values pounded into my consciousness I mean, driven into my being, so that when I come to these moral intersections and I have decisions that need to be made, when I get there, I must know what is the right thing to do. And with God's help, I've got to put one foot in front of the other and walk in the direction of right. And you need the same thing, and you're just naive if you say that you don't. And so I'll say it again at the risk of repeating myself. Our greatest concern in life is not what might happen on Bay Street or Wall Street or who's going to be our next prime minister or who's going to win a Grammy Award or this or that. The greatest concern as we go forward in this word is, will I, will you read and heed this book? Read and heed. Because the Bible says that if we will, our life will be on a straight path and a sure foundation. If we don't read and heed this book, we're going to go out and we're going to look to our own mind or to our own heart or to our own will. And it's going to fail us at those critical moral intersections. We'll be on a crooked path, we'll be on a weak foundation, and we will one day veer right off the road into the ditch and wreck our lives. You know, there's a final reason why I need this book so badly. I need to know what to do when I violate the values that God has asked me to obey in this book. I need to know what are the consequences for fouling up and what do I do about it. I need to know the penance requirements to get right with God again. I need to know how and where, a crude way of putting it, but how and where I pay my moral traffic tickets so I can get my record clean. And thanks be to God, that information is in this book too. The values are in this book. And what to do when you violate the values, it's in there too. And as many of us have learned in church over the years, there's some counterintuitive logic in this book. Against all human logic, the Bible teaches that the penance-paying approach does not work in God's economy, that we can't do it. It's just not the way he set up his redemptive program. Titus 3:5 says, not by doing good works will you be made right with God. Ephesians 2:8 and 9 says, for by grace you are saved, not by doing works, not by works so that no man may boast. Salvation for your soul and for mine, when we've done wrong, has been made available to you free. It's been made available for me free. On the merits of Jesus Christ. You see, he never sinned. And when Jesus went to the cross, the Bible teaches he took upon himself every moral offense that you've piled up in your life and every one that I have. And when he cried, it is finished, he was declaring to the whole world and for all time that moral offenses have been atoned for. And all people like you and me have to do is ask for Christ's atoning work on the cross to be applied to our own moral debt. And when we do that, we are set free from the curse and consequences of our sin. We are free on the merits of another. Our slate has been wiped clean at the cost of the death of Jesus Christ. And you find that information and you find that story in this book. I need this book. I need to read it and heed it. And, you know, not as a guilt-tripping thing, not as a chore that, well, you know, I guess I better do my devotions. I guess I better, you know, open up that app and look at my verse for the day or give a few minutes here or there. No, you need this like a drowning man needs water. We need this book alive within us. And we elevate it and trust it and live it in a way we give no other philosophy, system, book, or teaching. Our society is confused. It's lost. It's running in sheer madness. Madness in the wrong direction. You will too. Unless you read and heed this book. It's a gift from God. Just like the gift of his son, Jesus, is. I've asked Pastor Dave if he would come now and lead us in our time of communion.
Thanks, Pastor Jim. Wow, is that ever so true? I don't know what I would do without the Word of God in my life. It makes the difference between life that goes according to God's plan and life that doesn't. And I've certainly experienced enough of what it's like without Him to never want to do that again. If you haven't already grabbed a communion pot on one of the side tables, you take a moment to do that, and we're going to celebrate the Lord's table together on the night that Jesus, the living Word, was betrayed. He took the bread, and He broke it, and He said, "This is my body, broken for you. And whenever you eat it in remembrance of me." Let's eat it together. And as He took the cup, He said, "This is the cup that represents the new covenant. Whenever you drink it in remembrance of me." Let's drink it together. We thank you, Lord, this morning for the opportunity to be together, gathered in your name, like your word says. We thank you, Lord God, for the difference that it makes in all of our lives, Lord, to be placed together for your purposes. That this week, Lord, is another week that stretches out in front of us. Our need for you was just as great as it was last week and the week that come and the week to come after that, Lord. We thank you, Lord, that you are with us every single step, Lord. We honor you and praise you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Choose to praise
glorify, glorify the name of all names. That nothing can stand against, and I choose to praise. Glorify, glorify the name of all names. That nothing can stand against. Oh yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. Yes, I will bless your name. Yes, I will sing for joy when my heart is heavy all my days. Oh yes, I will. Oh yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. Yes, I will bless your name. Yes, I will sing for joy when my heart is heavy all my days. Oh yes, I will for all my days. Oh yes, I will for all my days. Yes, I will. Oh yes, I will.
Yes, God, we choose to praise you. Thank you for your word that gives us guidance in every situation in our life. God, help me to apply it more often. Thank you for today's message, Lord. Pray that it encourages everybody. You go with us, Lord. You're preparing our pathways and situations, God. Thank you that you have everything under control. Amen. Amen. So go in the power of his might and have a great Sunday and a good week. Be blessed. Amen.